For an entire generation, people have experienced Star Wars the only way it's been possible, on the TV screen. But if you've only seen it this way, you haven't seen it at all.
This is the podcast you're looking for.
We've been waiting for you.
The Force is strong here, even stronger than the coffee.
Welcome to Coffee with Kenobi. Here are your hosts, Dan Z and Corey Club.
Hello, this is Dan Z, and welcome to show number 21 of Coffee with Kenobi, a Star Wars podcast that analyzes our favorite saga in a whole new way. With me is my good friend and co-host, Corey Club.
Hello, everybody. Make sure to catch our first episode of Cup of Clone Wars, where we analyze Star Wars, The Clone Wars. Our premiere episode features the Force cast, Eric Geller. We explore the Order 66 arc in detail. We had a great time talking with Eric, and we look forward to reviewing Season 6 this summer with a few familiar faces and very special guests, as well as our contest winner, who will review an arc of the Clone Wars with us. We also hope you catch our coffee chat with John Morton, known to Star Wars fans as Dak from The Empire Strikes Back. John was gracious enough to join us to discuss a wide variety of topics that you are sure to find fascinating. In addition, be sure to check out Dan's new blog covering Star Wars in the Classroom's network of teachers. Find out how you too can be a member of this awesome network.
In today's show, we are happy to share a cup of coffee with Ricky Brigante of Inside the Magic. Ricky will be joining us to talk about the Disney Star Wars theme park connection and the history behind the joining of these two popular culture juggernauts. Our Star Wars Weekend's contributor, Aaron Harris, stops by to share his experiences at the annual event. We have the next offering of your espresso shot with Beard Trio with Rob Wainfur.
We will also update you with the first bit of Episode 8 news, Harrison Ford's injury on the set of Episode 7, and collector news featuring lightsabers, as well as the Hero Series Millenium Falcon. We'll also introduce our topic for show number 22, and now let's see what's brewing in the Star Wars universe this week.
Oh wait, this is interesting.
You found something.
For our first news story, it has to do with Episode 8, our first little bit of news here.
How about that?
It's excellent news. We love to hear all kinds of breaking news. They've announced the director, Rian Johnson, for Episode 8. He's looking to helm that film and then write a story treatment for Episode 9.
He's also writing Episode 8 as well.
Oh, is he writing it? I'd say I didn't know that part of it.
So. Yeah, he was on your site. What are you doing?
I just skim it. I skim everything.
Well, there's so much going on. Lisa does a great job. I would say probably over half of our posts come from Lisa, and sometimes I get my Star Wars news from our website, courtesy of Lisa, so thank you for that. It's pretty awesome, Lisa. So yeah, he's directing and writing Episode 8, and that sort of came out of nowhere, I would say. Still, at least at the time of recording this, it hasn't showed up on StarWars.com, but Variety and The Hollywood Reporter and everybody's posting it. Steve Sansweet even made a post about it, so to me, that's pretty official.
It is.
So we're going with it, and we know, and like you said, he's writing a treatment for Episode 9, but he is not, at least again at the time of this recording, directing Episode 9, which means, of course, that we're just like the original trilogy as far as a different director for each film.
Exactly, Dan. And they're bringing kind of these young guns in, and I don't know how they're picking these guys, but I mean, obviously these are younger directors who don't have a whole lot of films under their belt. But we know that Rian Johnson has done Brick, and his follow-up to that was a sci-fi time travel movie called Looper.
And you saw that, right?
I saw both those movies, and they both...
I haven't seen either. I haven't even heard of Brick.
Oh, come on, check them out, man.
What's it about?
Brick is kind of like a high school detective type movie where it stars Joseph Gordon-Levitt, and he kind of goes around. It's kind of like kind of tongue in cheek, and it's like. Where they're kind of like wise guys, but it's a high school
clever.
Setting. Yeah, it's like, clever. It's interesting. And of course, Looper is like a sci-fi time travel movie. It stars Bruce Willis.
Right?
Yeah. It's interesting. It's cool the way they do it. And so
I heard there was some kind of beef about the end, which I don't know anything about that.
I suggest you check it out and see for yourself.
I think it'll be cool. Well, it's got to be better than Pacific Rim.
Oh, we love Pacific Rim.
This is really fun because. You know, again, Episode 8 news comes out of nowhere. We have this vision. I like the idea of different directors putting a different spin on things. Are you disappointed at all that J.J. Abrams is not going to be back for Episodes 8 and 9?
No, I'm not disappointed.
I mean, I guess it would be cool, but I also think it's neat to have the fresh blood. And in episode 7, by all accounts, I'm sure it's going to be fantastic. But I don't know. I think it's kind of neat. I sort of like it.
I'm also glad they're giving these young guys a chance, a shot, because I feel like it's almost like they're picking these guys because that they have that young blood in them, like you said. Mm-hmm. And they're ready to... I mean, they grew up with Star Wars, too. I mean, I'm sure that's influenced them to get into filmmaking.
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, I would assume that this is their dream project if, you know, they end up doing it officially. So, we're excited.
Yeah, this is great stuff. Our next news story is certainly not as exciting as our story for the first one. It's actually one that came out of nowhere as well. And it was pretty heart-wrenching because Harrison Ford, Han Solo... who was injured on the set of episode 7, and at first glance it seemed like he had broken his ankle, but now it turns out that he's broken his leg. He's going to be out for an extended amount of time, I believe at least 2 months, and they've come out and said that he's going to rehab back in the United States, and it doesn't appear that it's going to affect the shooting schedule for episode 7. It's sort of unclear, to be honest. It depends on who you ask or who you read on Twitter at what time of day, honestly. And a lot of people are speculating, and ultimately what it boils down to this, he's an awesome actor, he's an icon, and he hurt himself on the set of one of our future favorite films, so we wish him nothing but the best of health.
Yeah, it's a bummer for you know, the film all around. I think for the actors and directors, just I feel bad for him, because it's, you know, you work with somebody for so long, or you know, he's a friend, and he gets hurt, it's an accident, you know, and has this problem. But I think they're trying to really work hard to be able to schedule so that they don't fall behind in their filming and their shooting scenes and stuff like that. So I think when it comes down to it, I think they're really trying hard just to get him back on his feet and get him going so we can get in theaters.
Were you nervous at all that some of the people saying that, what if he couldn't be in the movie and things like that? That's not going to happen.
I don't think so. But, I mean, I think,
man,
even
that
I think
would be
even Harrison.
Yeah,
I even think Harrison would want to, you know, get going again and get better as fast as possible, just so he could be in the movie. I mean, I think he wants to be in the movie and enjoy it. And I think too. I mean, if anything comes down to it, they would either maybe cut back on some of his scenes or just, you know, wait till the end. Or I don't know. I mean, they'll work it out. It's not like this hasn't happened before. They're professionals.
Yeah, and I don't think they're going to cut anything out. They'll just have to rearrange stuff. And,
right.
And I think I heard this on the Cantina cast. I think Joe has said that during the third Iron Man, Robert Downey Jr., he was injured, so they just did various little tricks. And he's practically in every frame of Iron Man 3, so there are certainly ways to do it. Shoot him from the waist up or who knows what. But we're nothing but optimistic, as always. And we look forward to seeing Episode 7 with Harrison Ford on the big screen. This will just be... in one of the future making of books, it'll just be part of the legend, part of the legacy. Yeah,
exactly. Our third story has to do with a little bit of a celebration for us as Illinoisans.
Yeah.
It was announced that the Lucas Cultural Arts Museum is going to be constructed in Chicago. Pretty exciting for us, as we definitely make a road trip, Dan, go see this.
We've definitely got time to save for gas money, because it's just a quick drive. I don't know, a quick drive, about a 2-hour drive for us to head up there. But it's not going to be completed until 2018. But it's going to be near the Jet Aquarium, the Field Museum, and the Adler Planetarium on Chicago's lakefront. A beautiful area. We're extremely excited about it. And this came out today, so we were able to plug it into our show. Apparently, one of the biggest factors was that Chicago, this surprised me, was a bigger draw for tourists. In 2012, Chicago had over 46 million visitors. Hmm. San Francisco had 16 million. That's a huge gap.
Yeah.
Plus, of course, he's married to Millie Hobson from Chicago, so it's like his second home to him. But,
oh, sure.
Man, wouldn't it be great? And there's not a podcaster or a Star Wars fan alive who isn't thinking, oh, my gosh, maybe I could meet George Lucas in Chicago.
We definitely are.
Well, that would be amazing, wouldn't
it? That'd be incredible. We'd love something like that, to sit down with George and walk through the museum and get a personal tour. It'd be excellent.
I like your optimism, my friend.
Hey, you got to stay optimistic.
That's right. That's right. So that's definitely exciting. It has to be, there's pending approval by the Chicago Plan Commission. And I guess the architectural plans are going to be submitted to the city this fall. So there's still much work that has to be done. But we're very excited and optimistic. We're sorry to the people who were hoping that it was going to go out on the West Coast, but it's nice to have something in Central Illinois that's Star Wars centric. So we're thrilled here at Coffee with Kenobi about this. Our next news story was very exciting for us, of course, at Coffee with Kenobi. We were featured on the official blog. This is the second time that our show was on the official blog, and basically this is Amy Radcliffe. She does her fully operational fandom. It's a great blog that she does for StarWars.com, where she focuses on different things that Star Wars fans are doing, the 501st, the Mercs, all kinds of exciting things, the droid builders. And this time she picked podcasts. Now, the first round of this, and we had known we were going to be in this for a little over a month, she contacted us and we submitted our answers, and we knew we weren't going to make the first one because it was a very, very long blog that they wanted to break into two parts. So the first batch had Rebel Force Radio, The Force Cast, and Tashi Station. And then the second round had our friends Full of Sith, it had Star Wars Bookworms, and then it had us. And it said that there are over 70 Star Wars podcasts out there, which I was not aware of. So to be included is one of the top six that she covered on that blog was truly wonderful. So, and I have reason to believe, Corey, there may be more exciting things coming for Coffee with Kenobi via the StarWars.com website.
Right. We don't want to talk about spoilers around here. So.
Oh, good point.
No, I want to thank Amy as well for yes. putting us on there. She runs an excellent blog. Guys, go check it out and tell us what you think. Our next news story has to do with the past Star Wars weekends down in Disney World. Our good friend Aaron Harris had the privilege of going down every weekend and being part of all that hubbub down there and all the fans and the celebrities and seeing all the events and getting signings. And he was sending pictures out on Twitter and doing all kinds of fun things, keeping us updated. We had a little interview with him about his experience, and here it is.
Well, for our next news story, we absolutely had to have this burgeoning Star Wars celebrity, Mr. Aaron Harris himself, our Star Wars Weekends correspondent, our contributor, just an all around awesome guy and friend. And Aaron, it's been such a thrill for Corey and I. Every time that you'd send us messages through Twitter or Facebook or text us and tell us what was going on for Star Wars Weekends, just kind of give us your overall ideas about what has happened through Star Wars Weekends and sort of the cool things that you got to find.
Wow. I tell you guys, it has been amazing these last 5 weeks. It has been absolutely crazy. Wow. Just the sheer amount of Star Wars that's been going on. Guys, I can't thank you enough for the opportunity to work with you guys and cover the weekends for you, because it has opened up a lot of doors and made it a lot of fun. Because I got to meet a lot of people. We recognized the shirt and recognized the show and talked to a lot of people. And it has been such a blast. And I don't even know where to begin because so much has happened.
Well, yeah, tell us some of the pretty cool.
Yeah, some of the highlights that you got to see, and best celebrity or best encounter or something like that.
Oh, absolutely. And it was a weekend definitely full of encounters, that's for sure. The cast of Rebels that I got to meet, Taylor Gray was there, Vanessa Marshall, Tia Sikar, Jeff Bloom, all were there, and some of the nicest people you'll ever meet. I know when I met Vanessa Marshall, I walked up, she saw the Coffee with Kenobi shirt. Next thing I know, she was off her little stand out of her chair, giving me the biggest hug, like she knew me already.
That's so cool.
It was great. It was great. And she sends greetings to you guys.
That's awesome.
Great.
She was awesome and very, very wonderful. They all were. And they were all excited to be a part of Star Wars. Another big highlight that, of course, it lit up the internet there for a little while on week four was Mark Hamill.
Yes. And you saw him twice, didn't you?
I saw Saturday and Sunday. Saw both of those shows. And I was blessed enough to be inside the theater where he was, not in the They televised it in other parts of the park as well for people who couldn't make it in the theater.
Oh.
I was blessed enough to be in the theater both days in the same room as Mark Hamill, which was just awesome.
It's surreal. What were your seats like?
It was a full theater, so I was near the back both times, but still had great seats, came out with some great photos, which should, by the time this airs, will be up. And he was hilarious. You could tell he just was in his element. He loved being there with the fans. He wanted, and if you could tell if Disney would have let him, he would have done more interacting. He would have been
off
stage with the people. The biggest memory I take from that weekend is how I came so close to scoring Mark Hamill's autograph.
Oh, what happened?
Ooh, tell us, yeah.
of course, Friday, the news lit up the internet with Mark Hamill that after the parade hits the main stage, they do a little show, then they come down off the stage, get in their cars, and go back down the main Hollywood Boulevard and the motorcade as they head back to the back again.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Friday, he came off stage and was signing autographs. Okay. So I figured, you know what? We can give this a shot. So Sunday, I bumped into a friend that I met week one. And you probably read about it in the blog, saw the post.
Yeah.
Cody, his wife Jen, and their daughter Izzy. And they're the ones that brought some of the delicious cinnamon buns, which at 6 o'clock in the morning when you stand in the line on putting on an autograph, were heaven on earth. But I was with them and we decided, you know, we're going to camp out in that general area where he comes off stage and see if we can get Scores autograph. And Cody had some experience with getting autographs from baseball games and baseball players. And he had this idea because he's done it in the past where he uses his daughter to entice the celebrity to come over because they're more at the sign for an adult. And so we're standing there. We stood there for probably about an hour and a half, almost 2 hours waiting. And the parade came. They did the show. We're standing there. Here comes Mark Hamill off the stage, down the steps, and he's walking around. Everybody's shouting his name, Mark, Mark, Mark. And he comes off. He's waving at everybody. And little Izzy, God love her, is standing between me and her dad. And we were the first three people that he would have seen when he came off stage.
Mm.
And, of course, everybody's yelling at him, and she is yelling louder than anybody else there. It was amazing. And she was 6, 7 years old, I think she is. And she was leaning over the little rope they had, security rope, with a copy of Return of the Jedi DVD in her hand, and leaning as far as she could read, just shouting out, Mark, Mark. And he's waving at everybody, and then he sees her, and he stops dead in his tracks. And
wow.
He's just looking at her. And he looks at her for a second, then he turns and starts walking over to her. And he's like, you know, I'm really not supposed to sign anything, but I think I can make one exception.
Right.
And he's walking over to her, and he gets literally four or five feet from us. And
wow.
Cody and I are looking at each other thinking, we have done it. And about that time, a cast member intercepts him and directs him back to his car.
Oh,
we had it.
But what a memory.
That's so he saw it. You actually made eye contact with Luke Skywalker.
Yes. Oh, I know. I got chills the rest of the day after that.
That's so cool.
That is cool. One of the biggest thrills for me, as I mentioned before, is like I would wake up and I would see that you had your bracelets to get autographs and things like that. And you mentioned the Star Wars celebrities were really, really nice. And Vanessa was awesome. Just tell us all the celebrities you met. Did you meet the entire cast of Rebels?
I got everybody from Rebels who was there. Steve Blum, Tia Sickhart, Taylor Gray, Vanessa Marshall were all there. Unfortunately, Freddie Prinze Jr. couldn't be there. Then again, if he was there, you know,
you'd still be in line, probably.
Yeah, we'd still be in line. And of course, we'd all be looking for Sarah Michelle Gellar as well.
Oh, sure.
All that.
I'd be in that line rather than his line.
Yes.
But, met those cast of Rebels. And then, of course, it was just great meeting the celebrities, other celebrities that were there. John Ratzenberger, who was
you met a legend who's really not known for Star Wars. He's very famous for Cheers and Pixar, and you met an icon there.
Oh, absolutely, and a huge name in Hollywood and in animation. I mean, if you don't know his work outside of Cheers, you don't know what you're missing with Toy Story, his hand in Toy Story,
yeah,
Mack Truck and Cars. I mean, so he's got a long list of accolades to his name, and it was an honor to meet him. And he liked the name of the show because I had the Coffee with Kenobi shirt on. He took a look at that and he goes, "Coffee with Kenobi, that's a smart name."
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. And then he asked which one of you two were doing the Obi-Wan impressions. I said, "Well, actually, neither of them didn't do. That's what we got, James Arnold Taylor."
There you go. Yep.
And he goes, "Oh, yeah, that guy's around here somewhere."
He sure was. You probably saw him a lot.
I did. James Arnold Taylor was all over the place as the host. He was hosting Stars of the Saga. He hosted the Mark Hamill conversation with Mark Hamill that was there week four. And of course, he was the main stage host for the fireworks show, for the parade. So he was bouncing all over the place. And the best part about that was week two. We were sitting out, me and my friend Robbie, we were sitting outside of the Premier Theater. We had fast passes for the Rebel show that week, which would have been, who was there that week? That was Tia Sikkar, who was there that week. And we're sitting outside, just, we had nothing else to do. We had an hour before the show, so we were just sitting first in line so we can make sure we got the best seats we could. And we're sitting there, and I'm just sitting on the ground, and all of a sudden the side door to the theater opens, and out walks James Arnold Taylor. And he walks by, and he's like, "Hey, how you doing?" I'm like, "Hey." And he walked by, stopped dead in his tracks, turned around, he goes, "Ah, Coffee with Kenobi. I know that show. Do you know those guys?" I'm like, "Well, actually, yes, I do." And I introduced myself, told him I was covering the weekends for you. Then, of course, he came back, and we started talking. He talked about being on the show and how much fun he had.
Wow.
And then he's like, "Let's take some pictures." So we snapped some pictures and had a good time. Then, of course, he had to take off to get to where he had to go. And it was fun. It was a lot of fun to have that off the beaten track contact with him, because it wasn't like it was an interview session or an autograph session where everybody was there in line and he only had a few minutes. This was him taking time out of his day to talk.
And he recognized that the shirt, which you won that shirt, didn't you, in our first contest?
Yep, sure did. Sure did. Won that in the first contest. And it's held together for the most part.
Made it through all the weekends, huh?
It made it through the weekends. I don't know if it'll make it through another one. I may have to order another one before the
time's up. Funny.
But it held together quite well, and it was quite recognized. Matter of fact, week five, when I was there, I was in Darth Maul, actually, and was just going through the line. No, this was week four. Sorry. Week four, I was going through the line in Darth Maul, and a guy stopped me and goes, "Hey, Coffee with Kenobi." And I turn around, it's just a Disney cast member. And he's like, I'm like, "Hey, how you doing?" We started talking, and apparently he listens to the show.
Wow.
So if you're listening, how you doing? This is your moment of fame. But yeah, we talked a few minutes, and he told me how much he enjoyed the show and looked forward to what was to come there. So
wow, I didn't know that. That's really did. And you said that some people had stopped you and either liked the show or had heard of the show. That to me, that just blows my mind.
Oh yeah, it was exciting. A lot of people would stop and tell me how they liked the shirt, and I'd get a chance to tell them about the show. Or a couple people even recognized the shirt and the logo and the show, and we got to talk a few minutes about that. So it was a lot of fun, a lot of fun, a lot of recognition, a lot of tried to do as much promoting as possible for the show as we could. So.
Well, you did an amazing job. I mean, we could never repay you for all the kindness you've shown our show. And it's been pretty exciting. And really, let's be honest, the attention you got and the things that happened to you weren't because of a show, just because of the kind of guy you are and your sincerity and your warmth and your passion for Star Wars. So we're very blessed to have you, Aaron, and we consider you friends, and we look forward to you blogging for the show in the future. And as far as we're concerned, Star Wars Weekends isn't Star Wars Weekends without Aaron Harris.
Well, I appreciate that, and I can say it's been an honor, and it's been a blast working with you guys and covering the weekends for Coffee with Kenobi, because it's so easy to work for something when you know what you're working for is great, and you guys have done a great job with the show, and I'm just excited and have been giddy to be a part of it.
Well, thank you very much. And I will say, hopefully, maybe along the lines next year, we'll be able to, or the next Star Wars weekends, we'll be able to tag along with you and have some more fun.
Oh, absolutely. That would just be awesome. That would be icing on the cake right there. Here we go.
Well, before we let you go, Aaron, I know it's late in the Sunshine State. Tell us a little bit about Darth Maul, because, of course, I'm a collector. I'm a merchandise hound, and just knowing there's all those exclusives there, and the vinyl mations, and the T-shirts, and I've been to Darth Maul 4 years ago. What was that like? What did you see that you liked? What did you pick up?
Well, Darth Maul, of course, it was awesome. It seemed a little smaller than it has in the past couple of years that I've been there. They changed the location. It wasn't in the tent like it used to be. It was a little more condensed. I was impressed though with they upgraded the snack bar in Darth Maul.
I love that. Yeah,
snack bar. They even had an automated Akbar in the corner with one of the little stormtrooper mugs drinking out of it, which really made it nice. Art gallery was a little smaller than normal, but still had some great pieces there, and it was all kinds of nice stuff. They had a lot of the stuff they had wasn't necessarily exclusive to the weekends. When it comes to action figures and some of the Disney T-shirts that they had. They did have some exclusive pieces, though, with the vinyl. They had released a new vinyl, an exclusive vinylmation every weekend. Of course, I'm more of a pen person myself, so I picked up the pens for the weekend.
Was it in the clear box, or what was it?
The
exclusives every week?
The exclusives each week they had set aside. You actually had to go into a certain area and pick that up.
How did I miss this? What were the exclusives?
Let's see here. There was a vinylmation of a Jawa and the red droid from A New Hope.
R5D4,
that was it. I couldn't think of his name. There was a Emperor of vinylmation. There was the Rancor and the Rancor Keeper.
Mm.
Which was kind of humorous to look at. it just really, did not make you scared of the Rancor anymore when you see him with Mickey ears.
not a sense you ever thought you'd say in your life, but here we are.
Yeah, exactly. When did I ever think I would say the Rancor just doesn't scare me anymore? But they had some good stuff. I picked up one of the exclusive pieces that they had was a Medal of Yavin.
Oh, cool.
So that I picked that up. That's real nice. Of course, the picked up a travel coffee mug that they had. And of course, some other random pieces throughout the park, and mostly pins and stuff that I like to collect, like the poster pin for the celebration or for Star Wars weekends. They had some great, great shirts that they released, and a lot of Rebel stuff. You can tell this was the beginning. You could tell this was the beginning of their push for Rebels, especially with everything that they had with their video screens at the main stage were very much broadcasting a lot of Rebel propaganda. The Stormtrooper skits always involved them looking for the new Rebels that were out and about. So it was very much very hyped and geared towards Star Wars Rebels because it's right around the corner.
And it shows you where Disney's focus is and the exciting things that are coming from them. I think it's probably safe to say, I can't speak for everyone clearly, but I feel like a lot of people who are not so sure about this Disney acquisition of Lucasfilm, when they see what Disney has been doing with Star Wars and how reverential they are with Star Wars through Star Wars Weekends, I'm hoping that it persuade a lot of people to believe that the best could be yet to come. Well, Aaron, we'll let you go. Thank you again so much for all the amazing things you've done in the coverage and in the the endless hours and the lack of sleep, all the things you did for the love of your fandom. We applaud you and salute you, my friend. On behalf of all of our listeners, thank you so much for being for covering Star Wars Weekends for us.
It's been my pleasure, guys. Thanks for the opportunity, and I look forward to doing it again next year when it rolls around.
Thanks,
Aaron. Talk to you later, guys. Have a good night.
Bye, Aaron.
Bye.
And now let's join Rob Wainfur as he pours your espresso shot with the Bearded Trio.
And now your espresso shot with the Bearded Trio.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another Espresso Shop with the Bearded Trio. I'm Rob Wainfur, bringing you the latest on Spielberg, Lucas, and Williams. And let's start with some Spielberg news. Three-times Tony Award winner Mark Rylance is set to join the as-of-yet untitled Cold War film, which is being produced by DreamWorks. The project will see Tom Hanks and Steven Spielberg team up once more, and production is set to begin this autumn. Now, the script will be written by the Coen brothers. The untitled project is based on the true story of James Donovan, who Hanks will portray. Donovan was the American attorney enlisted by the CIA during the Cold War to negotiate the 1962 release of Francis Gary Powers, the U-2 spy plane pilot who was shot down over Russia 2 years earlier. Now, Lincoln star Daniel Day-Lewis, or should I say Sir Daniel Day-Lewis, has been made a knight in this year's Queen's Birthday Honours. The actor, who starred in the title role of the Steven Spielberg-directed movie, is among other stars who were also honoured. Damien Lewis of Band of Brothers and Harry Potter's Dame Maggie Smith were also among those honoured. American actress Angelina Jolie also got an honorary damehood. Lucasfilm Limited has appointed Teresa Cheng to the post of General Manager for Lucasfilm Singapore. Cheng joins Lucasfilm from DreamWorks Animation, where she had the position of Senior Production Executive. Lucasfilm President Kathleen Kennedy said she brings an energy and passion to her work that I know will benefit the studio and the relationships we've built while continuing to forge new relationships in the region. We wish Cheng all the best in her new role at Lucasfilm. Now, a few weeks ago, the people of Detroit had a double treat as John Williams conducted the Detroit Symphony Orchestra at the Orchestra Hall. Joining them on stage was longtime friend Steven Spielberg. Now, during the event, on the large screen above them were clips from some of Spielberg's finest films, such as Close Encounters and Raiders of the Lost Ark. Now, accompanying the clips, the DSO played signature tunes from each movie shown. Steven Spielberg said, "If a movie can strike like lightning, then the score can be like thunder. I can direct bicycles to fly over the moon, but the music makes them fly." Now, at one point during the evening, a clip was shown of Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade with no music from John Williams. "Let me show you how boring I can be without Johnny Williams," said Steven Spielberg. Then the same clip was replayed with the famous John Williams soundtrack, amplifying how important it is to have a good soundtrack, especially from John Williams. Now, the orchestra raised $1.2 million during the month of May. Now, the Detroit Symphony Orchestra is a community orchestra and raises three-quarters of its budgets from contributions alone.
Manuel, are you in love with her?
Love? Love is for the living, Sal. I'm only after her for one reason. She's my ticket out of here.
Now, if you recognize that clip, then chances are you're going to love this next story. Grim Fandango, the LucasArts classic from Tim Schafer, is getting a makeover and heading to PS4. Announced at E3 and stole the limelight, Double Fine Studios, along with other contributions, will see the 1998 classic brought up to date. Grim Fandango is a gripping story set in the afterlife about one man's journey, Manny, in a dark underworld fraught with mystery and intrigue. The announcement only mentioned the PS4, but expect other platforms to get the LucasArts classic soon. Now, I asked Tim Schafer last week why you should buy Grim Fandango, and his response? It's good practice for the afterlife.
I'm getting out of here. This world's for suckers.
DreamsAndVisionPress.com contacted the Bearded Trio to inform us of their Kickstarter campaign they currently have going. Their ambition is to bring us Ralph McQuarrie fans a 400-plus-page coffee table book, featuring the largest collection of Ralph McQuarrie's non-Star Wars art ever published. They were kind enough to send us some concept drawings the great McQuarrie did for Spielberg's E.T. You can check them out on our site and also make sure to check out and support their Kickstarter campaign. Head over to Kickstarter and search Ralph McQuarrie. Alternatively, you can head over to the Bearded Trio and you'll see the Kickstarter widget in the top right-hand corner. And finally, a short tweet from the official Star Wars Twitter account clarified that John Williams is only signed on for Star Wars 7 at this time. Now, not sure what prompted the need to clarify this, but shortly after, via Deadline's website, it was announced that Rian Johnson was on board for Star Wars Episodes 8 and 9. Now, at the time of recording this, that news is still unofficial. There's no mention of it on the Star Wars official website. But I will say that if it is true that Johnson's last three movies as director, he has chosen his cousin Nathan Johnson to compose the music. So just in case, it might be worth just checking out some of Nathan Johnson's previous soundtrack work. Stay tuned on that one. And that wraps up your Espresso Shot with the Bearded Trio. I hope you enjoyed it. Remember, you can keep up to date on our website, thebeardedtrio.com, and be sure to check out the premiere episode of Winding Down with Williams with me. Enjoy 40 minutes of relaxing fan renditions of John Williams classics from Harry Potter to Star Wars and lots more. You can check out the show section on the Coffee with Kenobi website for more details. Thanks again for listening, and I will see you soon. Goodbye.
Han Solo, Rebel Soldier, Lando Calrissian, and Bespin Guard each sold separately from Star Wars The Empire Strikes Back Collection, new from Kenner.
Looking? Found someone you have, I would say,
Your lightsabers will make a fine addition to my collection.
Our first bit of collector's news has to do with lightsabers. Seems to be the top-selling product for Disney. Disney taking on Lucasfilm, what was it, almost a year and a half ago?
Yeah.
So we've had, they've always had Star Wars attractions within Disney, the theme parks. So they have sold Star Wars merchandise.
Well, it says that they sold 10 million lightsabers last year. And it's not clear if among Star Wars merchandise, it's the lightsabers that are the best sellers, or among all Disney products. I'm going to assume that because of the demand for Frozen, that is the number one seller. But lightsaber is the number one thing that Disney has of Star Wars. And that includes right. Action figures, apparel, t-shirts, keychains, everything. Pretty awesome.
That's pretty awesome. I know that in Disney you can pretty much create your own lightsaber.
Yeah, I
kind
did.
Of a mix and match. Yeah, you did.
And of course, it's impossible to be totally satisfied with it. Because
you can walk out with the one you want, and you realize, I should have done something else.
Yeah, and there's some of the hilts that you like, but I don't know. Maybe I'll win that thing, and I'll be in Episode 7, and they'll design one for me. That's pretty much the only way I'm going to be satisfied.
There you go. Do you think, when they talk about lightsabers, is it these, plastic extendable ones?
I think it's everything. I'm sure it's like the props. The fancier ones, the nice, the ones that Master Replica used to make, that now Hasbro makes. It's probably primarily the ones that little kids can get in Toys R Us and Target and Walmart, I'm sure. I mean, they're well, awesome.
They would say 10 million sold within the course of just the first year, like we said. I don't know if that's just, stroke of genius, but...
pretty much.
Yeah, so Disney definitely knows what to do with their merchandising. They're geniuses themselves, putting stuff out there, and we're excited to see what they have coming out, obviously for Rebels and for Episode 7 and all kinds of crazy stuff going on, but...
it's only going to get bigger, especially when look at the Inquisitor's lightsaber. That's going to sell like gangbusters, too. Ooh, I like that, the disc. Is that how they describe it, or is that artistic awesomeness?
Sure, I try, but... No, it's like... I equate it to like a Tron disc. Lightsaber. Yeah, something like that. So,
our next collector news story is the Hero Series Millenium Falcon is coming out in the fall of 2014. I am not particularly familiar with the Hero Series. It does seem to me, I think they're doing an X-Wing with this as well. Uh-huh. They're large. This Millennium Falcon is over 2 feet long. That's pretty huge. It doesn't open. Like, you can't put figures in it.
Didn't they come out when they re-released in 97? Didn't they come out with another Millennium Falcon that was the, like...
In 97?
Well, when they had the releases.
Power of the Force. Yeah, I have it.
Power of the Force. Yes.
Yeah.
It opened up.
Mm-hmm. And you put figures in it and everything.
Yeah, it was like the old one.
Yeah. I think it's the same sculpt and everything.
What's the difference between this one and... This one.
Well, it's 2 feet long, so it's. I mean, you see, look at the show notes. Look at the picture on the bottom of that kid holding it.
Right. No, I'm looking at it right now.
Thing's huge. I think that's me. This kid's got a mullet. That's what
that
I look like
you.
When I was that age. Yeah. And
acne and all.
I guess they're guessing on Yoda News was where we got the information on this, but they're guessing a price point between $35 and $50,
which is reasonable.
Yeah. I mean, again, you can't put figures in or anything, but if it's just purely for display purposes, it does light up and the rotating radar dish and the cannon turret. So it looks pretty awesome. I'm sort of on the fence now with my old Power of the Force and if I want to sell it or not. And it's pretty cool. I'm probably going to have a hard time resisting, especially 35 to 50 isn't too bad for something like this.
There's one issue I do have with it.
I sense a joke coming on.
No, it's no joke.
No?
It's okay. Too clean looking. It needs to be battle damaged or beaten up.
Why?
I mean, because that's what the Millennium Falcon is.
Well,
I'm looking at the toy itself, though.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's
too clean,
pristine, but maybe they were on the Rebel base for a while. Did you notice the logo in the top right hand corner of Star Wars Rebels? It's got like a TV screen or a monitor, and it's got a remote control by it.
Well, here's what's interesting too. Yeah. So the packaging is kind of designed like Rebels. If you look at it, it's got the spider marks of
the orange and blue.
Yeah, the orange and blue, kind of that, and that fresh, you know, hot, vibrant feel. Like you said, it's hot. Yeah, it's cool looking. But here's the interesting fact. They're packaging it with Rebels. Will the Millennium Falcon be in Rebels?
Well, that's interesting that you said. Well, it is only in the corner. It just says Star Wars on the bottom right. And then in the bottom of the thing, it says Episode 5. So that's the Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah,
I think it's maybe just a tie-in. Yeah. And the Stormtrooper appears. I think that's the logo that Hasbro's going with, the Stormtrooper, for all the Rebel stuff.
Right.
It's all going to be focused on that. So maybe. I mean, there's, of course, Billy Dee Williams confirmed at Star Wars Weekends that he's voicing a character in Rebels,
yes.
And we're assuming that it's Lando, although this is a good time, even though this is our collector segment. How important is it to you to have characters from the original trilogy in Rebels?
How important is it to me?
Mm-hmm.
I could take it or leave it. I'm excited. I'm honestly really excited about these new characters. I think it's really cool. I'm ready for a new introduction to, you know, their stories and their backgrounds and get to know them. I'm really excited that we literally have no returning characters at this point that we know of. So, but Billy Dee Williams doing a voice of anybody would be excellent. So, I'm excited.
I agree with you. Take or leave. When the Clone Wars was in his prime, whenever there was a character from the original trilogy, I was happy about that and I thought that was cool. Mm-hmm. But this. I'll probably be similar, but I'm pulling back a little bit on that desire because to me, the introduction to all these characters canonically, I want them to be in the films 4, 5, and 6. I don't need to see Lando in Rebels. And if it does happen and he's in it, maybe I'll change my mind. I don't know. But we'll see. Again, I'm just going to defer to Dave Filoni. He hasn't failed us yet, so I have no reason to think he will now.
Can't wait to find out.
Hi, this is Ricky Brigante, host of Inside the Magic, and you are listening to Coffee with Kenobi with Dan Z and Corey Club. This is the podcast you're looking for.
Luke, you're going to find that many of the truths we cling to depend greatly on our own point of view.
I must be allowed to speak.
You've taken your first step into a larger world.
Our topic for show number 21 is the Disney theme parks and the Star Wars connection. What is the history between these two icons of entertainment and popular culture? What do you want to see at the Disney theme parks concerning Star Wars? And how will it affect the future of these two entertainment juggernauts? Joining us to discuss this topic is Ricky Brigante of the excellent Disney podcast Inside the Magic. Inside the Magic launched in 2005 and has been a staple of Disney news, interviews, and podcasting ever since. Ricky's podcast has inspired Disney fans for years, and he is a huge Star Wars fan as well. His knowledge and enthusiasm is contagious, and his insights and analysis are must-experience opportunities if you are a Disney or Star Wars fan. We are happy to have him on to join us for a cup of coffee. Welcome, Ricky.
Thank you so much for all the kind words. I'm happy to be here.
Absolutely. Well, we are thrilled to have you. We've when we started our show a little over a year ago, one of the first things I did when I was talking to Corey is I said, hey, you got to listen to this show. Have you ever heard Inside the Magic? And Corey was a slacker, Ricky. So we got him on board, and I just played the beginning, and your format and Ed Dalsta's the Indie Cast were big inspirations for us. So it's a real thrill for us to have you on and to talk Star Wars and Disney. Two of the best topics out there, of course.
Well, yeah, naturally. I mean, ever since those worlds officially collided a few years ago, it's been a lot of fun to see what has happened and a lot to look forward to, certainly.
Absolutely. So we'll just jump right into this. Can you talk to us about the history of the collaboration between Disney and Lucasfilm?
Gosh, I mean, it's been going on in the world of theme parks, certainly since the late 80s when Star Tours became a thing. Lucas and Disney have had sort of similar mindsets, I think, with regards to fantasy worlds and character building. And, it was a good sort of relationship for them to build many years ago. And Star Tours obviously has been a hit in all the parks that it's been in for decades now. And there have been other sort of relationships there that have worked. I mean, George Lucas had a hand in creating one of my favorite attractions of all time, Disney attractions. The extraterrestrial alien encounter at the Magic Kingdom.
Oh, wow.
His name was up on the placard. I don't know how much he actually had to do with that so much, but I'm sure his role was there somewhere. And, it's been really fun to watch it evolve from, okay, there's just this little tiny thing to now, gosh, who knows what's coming with Episode 7 and maybe a Star Wars land someday.
Oh, wow. Well, and I'm sure we on our show, we try not to speculate or dive into rumors, but it's hard to ignore what's going on. And of course, the news that the American Idol experience is closing. And then
right.
Has Disney actually come out and said that that Indiana Jones is going to be no more?
No, not officially. That's just a rumor that's going around. It seems inevitable that that's going to go away. But we do know. Disney is definitely working on some major projects for Star Wars in the parks. What exactly? They don't even know yet. They're still figuring that out.
Well, like you said, Disney and Lucasfilm and Star Wars, they're just two big giants in pop culture. I'm curious to know your take as far as what does Disney bring to Star Wars to ensure a long, exciting vision for the franchise and for the future of the saga?
Here's what I love about Disney owning Lucasfilm is that Disney is very good about staying relatively hands-off when it comes to acquiring these major companies. You can have a lot of integration. You can have a lot of cross-promotion and synergy and, Mickey Mouse dressed as characters and all that kind of stuff. But the crux of it, the real guts of it, I mean, if you look at Marvel, you look at Pixar, Disney doesn't come in and say, hey, we're doing this the Disney way. They buy these companies because they love what they're doing and they don't want to mess with that. And so for Disney to be involved with Lucasfilm, all that is just a vote of support. It's like, hey, you're doing awesome things that we want to be part of. We don't want to mess it up, but it's just sort of there aren't too many bigger entertainment companies on the face of this planet than Disney and Lucasfilm. And now, together joining forces, I think it's a tremendous possibility for, I mean, we already know there's many movies on the way, which we never thought was going to be a possibility. And who knows what else is to come. So I'm pretty excited about all of it.
Well, and particularly, and I'm sure you're very well aware of this as well, but when it was first announced, there were a lot of naysayers and they were worried about the Disneyfication, quote unquote, of Star Wars. And just like you said beautifully, I found that kind of an intriguing and absurd notion, if I can be frank, because again, Disney took over Marvel, and that has been nothing but an incredible success story all the way around. I think we have no reason but to be optimistic about what's going on.
Definitely. And I've talked to people at Disney about this. In fact, I it was a really interesting event that Disney put together fairly recently. It was billed as kind of an unveiling of Star Wars products coming to the Disney store, which is a relatively mundane topic. It's like, okay, yeah, we know what Star Wars toys are. Okay. But it wrapped in this sort of small press event that they held a few months ago in California was this greater notion of visiting the studios, visiting the parks, visiting Disney store, and bringing it all together under this umbrella of people who have been with Disney for years and wanting to express their love independently of that, with Star Wars and that whole realm, and having the two come together, they want to respect that, and they want to do what they can to make sure that they don't ruin so much history behind it, and just improve it from here on out.
Exactly, and I know you had mentioned this on Inside the Magic shortly after that had happened, and I was actually looking forward to asking you a little bit more detail. What was it like? You've been very fortunate. You've been to California a number of times. But when you went and got to see the reveal of those products at the Disney stores, I was able to get my hands on the Stormtrooper last weekend, and I was shocked that even though I knew the measurements for how big these things were, I couldn't believe the sculpt and the quality of the sound from them. I thought they were tremendous. But what was that whole experience like? I know you got to meet Steve Sansweet, which we were fortunate enough to talk to on our one-year anniversary show, but what was that whole thing like for you?
Yeah, it was great. I really wasn't even expecting as much of that. Steve Sansweet, as you mentioned, was there for the duration of the event, which it was a surprise to everybody there. So that was wonderful it was literally just hanging out with him for days. He was there along with the rest of us, awesome. learning alongside and sort of experiencing it and not knowing what was coming next, which was definitely fun. I mean, he's obviously got a long, long history with Star Wars, and certainly knows his merchandise, to say the least. Mm-hmm. But what struck me the most, the thing that pops out at me is one of the current VP of Disney Store, long before he was with Disney, and he's been in Disney for a very long time, he's been a Star Wars fan, and apparently in his house, he's got a tremendous Star Wars collection, not anywhere near the size of Rancho Obi-Wan, obviously, but he's got massive amounts of Star Wars stuff. And so for him to be able to now work on that sort of melding of Disney and Star Wars is a thrill. And what I'm really looking forward to, you mentioned those figurines and the talking and all of that, the die casts that are coming out.
Yes.
I'm really excited about that because they're huge. I can't wait to see the final product of that.
Well, any idea when that's going to come out? Because I think that might be the highlight of the collection.
I that was definitely for me. When I was looking at these things and they passed around those prototypes, I was like, wait a minute, this is really going to be all metal. You know, and diecasts are normally like Hot Wheels size. These things are like five times the size of that. I don't know when they're going to come out, but I will be buying every single one of them.
And I actually just went through my attic looking through some of my collectibles, and I found the original Kenner diecast, like the Slave One and the Millennium Falcon. So nice. I can't wait to see how these compare.
Yeah, well, judging from the prototypes, I think they're going to be wonderful. Although, as many fans were quick to point out, some pieces on the X-Wing prototype were put on backwards. But, that's why it's a prototype.
Well, and the gentleman you mentioned, there was a blog on StarWars.com about his excitement for being able to be a part of the franchising, design all these toys and collectibles. So it's pretty great when you see fans of the franchise incorporating professionally their love into the franchise as well.
Yeah, definitely. His name is Jonathan Story, and he's a really nice guy. I mean, I did get to go into his office at Disney Store headquarters, which that's a really wild place to walk around, as you might imagine. Sure. But his office is just wall to wall awesomeness. It's collectibles from 30, 40 years worth of stuff. There were like original Tron figures in there, and I was I just want to put some of this stuff in my pocket. And you didn't see that? No. But yeah, he's definitely the right guy to be sort of heading up all this.
So do we officially know at this point as far as expansion of Star Wars in the Disney theme parks worldwide?
We know nothing. And really, honestly, it's because Disney hasn't made any decisions yet. I mean, they're working on it actively. Back at the D23 Expo last August, I guess it's almost a year ago now, they were sort of teasing to the fans, you know, with some crates, intergalactic crates with like lightsaber markings on it. And
Orange Harvest,
there.
Right?
Yeah, exactly. And that's the code name for the project that they're working on. But Disney likes to take their time when it comes to the parks. We're watching Universal crank out crazy amounts of things right now. Diagon Alley sprung up from nowhere in the last 2 years, and it's incredible. And Disney does not work at that pace. They don't feel like they need to. They don't feel like they want to. They would want to approach it methodically and carefully. And especially with Episode 7 on the horizon, I know they want to work that into the story. And obviously, they can't throw anything Star Wars in the parks that relates to the new trilogy until we've seen the new trilogy. So it's sort of a careful, they're waiting for the film to be made. And then once they sort of get those, that information in, they can create what they want and, you know, and pull in some of the stuff from the old part. And then everyone will be happy once it gets there. But I don't anticipate that happening anytime in the near future. It's going to be a few years.
Yeah. And I know that you brought up Harry Potter and Diagon Alley. If anybody follows Inside the Magic on Twitter, Ricky, you've been posting pictures like crazy about your experience there. Could talk a little about that and how, you know, what we hope maybe that, you know, Star Wars will kind of glean from that.
You know, this thought crossed my head many times when I was walking through there. Last week, at Universal Orlando previewed for the press and celebrities and VIPs this incredible expansion of the Wizarding World of Harry Potter. And to say that it is the most detailed, the most immersive, the most impressive theme park land, theme park attraction, theme park experience that I've ever seen would Wow. even be an understatement. Wow. It is. You can imagine, okay, you get on an airplane, you travel to a city that you've never been, and you have sort of the freedom to explore and do whatever you want. That is what you feel like when you step in here. You don't realize you're in a theme park anymore. You have been transported to this other place that is suddenly, you know, it's formerly a fictional place, now made real. And if the amount of detail can be applied, has been applied to this, could be applied to the Star Wars universe, it would be, nobody would want to leave. You'd want to live there. There's parts of, I'm not even that big of a Harry Potter fan. I'm really not a Harry Potter fan at all, but the area is amazing. I wanted to spend days in there. And if Disney can do something like that with Star Wars, it's going to be incredible. You know, they need to steer away from things like, you know, I've heard rumors recently of like, oh, they're going to have a Dumbo style X-Wing ride. I'm like, nobody wants that. But yeah, then again, I've heard rumors of like a Dagobah swamp attraction where you can interact with Yoda and use the force to raise a life-size X-Wing out of the swamp. That's the type of thing that would be amazing. And Disney's trying to figure all that out. So I think they realize that the bar has been raised, the expectations have been raised, and if they don't sort of meet what people want out of a Star Wars experience, it could go very bad very quickly.
Well, they have taken the ad at the Hollywood Studios and made it. They have a fire breathing dragon, just this image of this larger than life thing through the skyline. And I was so happy to hear you talk about the Wizarding World like this, because I am a Harry Potter fan, but I'm more excited for the reasons you mentioned. If this is what we can expect from high quality theme parks, we have nothing but incredible reasons to just be salivating over the notion of what they can do with Star Wars. And I like, and you've emphasized this quite a bit on Inside the Magic, Disney takes their time. They're about quality. They're not really about the quantity of things. I mean, certainly they're not shy about building new resorts or things like that.
But when it comes to Vacation Club and timeshare, that pops up like a new one every 10 minutes, I swear.
If
they can make direct money on something, then they fast track it. But, you know, everything else takes its time.
Well, and imagine how excited I was that I proposed to my wife at Sunset Point at the Polynesian, then they knocked that down.
That's a whole other story. Now they're building what looks like Pizza Hut out there in the lagoon.
Oh, great. Well, maybe my wife and I can just visit any pizza and reminisce about when I proposed to her.
Just, you know, bring some drums or, you know, have a tiki drink and you'll be all set.
That's right. Have some people get in the way when I'm proposing, when I'm taking a picture.
Yeah, there you go.
Well, that's a perfect segue too, because man, it's like you've done podcasting before. Ricky, this is great, because we've asked some of our listeners to kind of tell us about their ultimate Star Wars theme park wish list that they would love to see come to fruition, and one of our listeners, Mark Mulcaster, he had said that he lives in London, closest park is Paris, and he's wondering what, if anything, would ever come out to Paris's way as far as Star Wars goes. And I'm just going to kind of brainstorming here, but I would assume that they're probably going to focus on the United States first.
Yeah, Paris is an interesting place right now. It's not the most successful parks, particularly the Walt Disney Studios park has been having some issues. They just opened are in the process of opening the new Ratatouille ride there. There was sort of the big media hoopla over the weekend. It officially opens in another couple of weeks or so. And I think that will be a tremendous help for that park, but it's still kind of a bizarre place. I haven't been there personally, which is part of the problem, is not a lot of people do. So I agree that if they're going to build
massive, huge, amazing Star Wars land. It's going to happen in the United States, except we don't know a lot about Shanghai Disneyland at this point. There's not really the same sort of lands that we know from the rest of the world. They've already announced one of the few things that they're going to have a massive Pirates of the Caribbean land there. They haven't really said much else about the rest of the park, so it could be that in place of Tomorrowland, we see Star Wars land instead. We just don't know.
Sure, and if they take what they've done with the Wizarding World and Tokyo Disney Sea,
yeah,
I mean those seem. I mean, I've never been there either, but those sound like the bars what we're reaching for.
That was the one thing that I heard while walking around Diagon Alley, and I was, you know, speechless and raving about it. And some people who I have not been to Disney Sea either, but I there were some people who had been there that said to me, I haven't seen anything like this since I was at Disney Sea. So wow. That is definitely sort of one of those comparisons that can be made. I definitely have to get there someday. I've heard it's just incredible.
Oh, every time you hear something about it, just wow. It just looks fantastic. So we have another listener, Ryder Waldron, wrote in, and he basically put three bullet points. He wants to have more chances for kids to lightsaber duel with Jedi Knights and Sith Lords, and it sounds like we'll have more to choose from.
Some adults would be nice in there too.
Yes, I agree with that. That would be very fun. And I think that would be great. I'm the guy that for our honeymoon, we went on a Disney cruise, and the first thing I wanted to do wasn't to check out the restaurants or our room. I wanted to go to see all the little kid places. I know it was our honeymoon, but I just wanted to see what it was like.
Well, you have to, because you only have that brief window when you first get on board to check out the kids area. And
you want to go down to Andy's slide.
And check out the Avengers area if you're on the Magic. And it's, you know, and then once you set sail, you're like, oh, now it's just for kids.
Well, yeah, I agree. And the writer says he also wants more Star Wars characters walking around. I'm assuming like Star Wars weekends. And then his last request, Tauntaun burgers.
They're frozen though, aren't they?
Yeah, they. You think they smell bad on the outside.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. They would be frozen and smell terrible. That doesn't sound very appealing.
No, it does not. That's how Pecos Bills used to be until they reworked it, I think.
Yeah. At least they'd have blue milkshakes, so that's good enough for me.
Well, of course. Well, that's actually great too, because... And let's just throw it out to the three of us. What are some of your ultimate Star Wars theme park ideas you'd love to see, whether it be attractions or lands or merchandise or food? What do you think? And Ricky, we'll just start with you. What are some of you, if you could have everything that you dream for in a Star Wars land at one of the Disney parks, what would you look for?
I think it's a no-brainer to have a cantina.
Absolutely,
you know, have that whole experience. You get to, you know, drink there, eat there, maybe even have a little moment where you can cut off somebody's arm with a lightsaber, you know, any of that. You can shoot first or second, you know, it's up to you.
I love it.
Beyond that, I don't know. It's a good question. There are so many iconic moments from Star Wars that I would love to live out those things. Like, this would be completely impossible, but I want to do the swinging across thing, you know, that Luke and Leia do. I mean, you have people shooting at you and you just sort of make that little leap and be on your way. That would be awesome. I don't know. You would have to sit there and like go through the films and just be like, what is actually feasible? I sort of get stuck in this, you know, you can think about the fantasy of it, but then you're like, oh, well, you can't really do that. It's like, I can't really, you know, I don't know, jump, fly through space. So you have to have Star Tours instead. So, I think
you could do the
more,
swing, I think. Well, you could do a foam pit or something.
It's the grounded things that I think are the most possible. Things that are environments to walk around, things that are like that, rather than the outer spacey stuff, I think is what Star Wars Land will mostly comprise. I mean, even just like having a Millennium Falcon, you could walk around and through and all of that. And I don't know what would happen on there, but it's something cool.
To me, that would be the ultimate. Yeah. If they had taken, since they're clearly building Episode 7, as J.J. Abrams so eloquently, subtly hinted to us. What if they took that and put that in California or Hollywood Studios or somewhere, and you could actually tour it and walk through? I think that would be incredible. What are some of your dream things, Corey?
I think a Falcon, a life-size Falcon, would be like the epitome of awesome. But I think also it'd be cool to have, like, you know, it seems like you walk in Disney and there's a different land for everything. It would be like a Mos Eisley you know, area. Yeah, a spaceport. So that way, you know, we got a kind of a neutral area. We can have multiple different things, and you have the cantina. You could have, you know, all kinds of other stuff. But I also think it'd be cool to kind of focus on the prequels a little bit too. I mean, have a pod race ride maybe. Something, you know, something like
really?
That.
Effect. I'm a little pod raced out.
You think so?
I think the pod race sequence of Star Tours is enough for me.
Yeah. You think so? All right.
Like, well, Corey, you've got it. You've got a lot of little kids. They probably love the pod.
Well, that's what I was actually thinking about my kids. That's so funny. Yeah. No, I think it's something like that would be kind of cool. But I think also, too, would be, I don't know how they would do it, but maybe like some kind of a life-size Death Star walkway with a big lighted walkways, little rat, little droids running around. I don't know.
Oh, the mouse droids?
I want to be encapsulated into the films, like you said about Harry Potter and the Diagon Alley. Just walk in and be like, okay, I'm here to stay, you know, because that'd be incredible.
That's the thing, that immersive experience that they're clearly doing over at Universal Studios. That I think that's what I want to feel. I think the Millennium Falcon would be terrific. Of course, the cantina is great. I can't help but I'm trying to control myself from laughing out loud about the idea of cutting off somebody's arm in a cantina.
You get to keep the arm then, right?
Yeah, right? That's a souvenir.
But you got to pay like $30.
Yeah. At least. It can be part of like when you take the pictures with everybody. But I think also would be cool, and I sort of thought this when you were mentioning what you thought would be fun, Ricky, but what if they could do like the old Back to the Future DeLoreans would make them snow speeds and do a Hoth battle sequence. That'd be fantastic.
Well, and then, of course, the speeder bikes would be, yes. Oh, yeah. Be awesome, yeah. As well.
Ewok, yeah, so, village of some sort?
Possible. Well, they kind of have that. Well, they already have that already at Star Tours. Mm-hmm. But you can't go through it, at least not without getting arrested. Well, so what about merchandise? I'm a huge merchandise person. I'm a huge collector. What are some things of merchandise? I mean, probably whatever we can dream Disney's already got on the
drawing
board anyway.
Well, no, so here's the thing that is separating Universal from Disney. When it comes to Disney merchandise, you've got plastic toys. You've got characters slapped all over T-shirts. You've got Disney characters dressed as Star Wars characters. You've got, you know, a lot of typical touristy, kitschy kids' toys. Universal has been very smart with their Potter merchandise is that it fits the theme. You don't see shirts with Harry Potter's face on it. You don't have a plush of one of the characters in the park. It's all stuff that would be sold in that area if that area mm-hmm. was real. You know, that's why the magic wands are selling like crazy, and the Hogwarts robes and the different sweaters for the different Hogwarts houses and all of that. I think for Star Wars merchandise to make sense in that type of an environment, that's what you'd have to, you know, they would be creative about it. What are the people who live in those universes buying? You know, if you're walking through, the Watto's shop, Watto's junk mm-hmm. shop, you know, what are you buying from him? What do you, you know, where do the Jedi get their robes? You know, there's gotta be money changing hands there somewhere. And I mean, Coruscant obviously is a city of business. You know, where do all of these transactions take place and what are people buying? I think that's the merchandise that I want.
I like that. I never really thought about it in quite that way, but that's exactly right. It makes more of that immersive experience that makes people feel like they're experiencing and living the films. It's really one of the reasons why the action figures became so popular in the late 70s, because people feel like they could take a part of the film home with them, and making it immersive like that is the way to go.
I think we've moved beyond that realm. I think we've been action figured to death.
Yes.
And I mean, the Black Series is cool. It's gotten me excited about Star Wars action figures again. I lapsed for quite a long time. I think I overdid it with the prequels. It's been nice to have, you know, sort of a new cool take on them, you know, bigger, more detail, all of that. But yeah, I mean, to have things that just sort of make more real sense, you know, as if Star Wars was real. That's I think, you know, people love buying the lightsabers for a reason. Puts you into the story, you know, more of that.
Well, those interactive wands they're saying, what if they did something like that with Star Wars hilts, like higher caliber hilts, and there were different booths you could go to, almost like some of the interactive games like the Phineas and Ferb and
Well, for Star Wars, I mean, this is something they absolutely could do. Okay, so if you're entering the Star Wars universe, what do you want to be? You want to be a Jedi, of course. Yeah. I mean, unless you want to be on the dark side of things. And either way, you're there because you want to use the Force. You want to have a lightsaber and you want to use the Force. So have sort of a training that teaches you to use the Force. And then throughout the land, have, I don't know what sort of thing you would need, or maybe you can just use your hands and some sort of sensor would sense movements that you're doing, but have the land be interactive that you can move stuff around. You know, you can open doors. Wow. You can do all of that. Yeah, I mean, the technology exists. Look at Xbox Kinect. You can wave your hands around and things go flying on your screen. You know, apply yeah. that to the real world and make the experience where it feels like you are a Jedi.
And who doesn't That's walk awesome. Into a grocery store and whoosh the doors open with exactly. their hand? I mean, come on.
Exactly. All three of us were probably thinking that at the same time.
Pretty much, yeah.
My wife still is like, are you doing that Jedi thing? You bet I am.
You tried the mind trick on her, doesn't work, but that's okay. Well,
okay, so imagine there's another step. Imagine that the cast members are, I don't know how this would work exactly, but the cast members are trained to recognize a certain aspect about certain people. Maybe you've gone through the Jedi training process, and so you're able to wave your hand in front of them and tell them things, and they'll obey you and go, you know.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Yeah, you're right. There it could tie it all into the magic bands. If they can sense that you're a higher level Jedi, suddenly they behave differently around you, and you can, you know, you're going to give me this drink for free, and here you go. That's not going to happen, but you get the point.
Absolutely. Well, that really would be cool. You don't need to take my magic band money. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, I should say, anyone out there, anyone from Disney, you're listening to this, take these ideas, please. I give you permission. I don't want credit. I don't want money. Take them. Make them happen. I'd be happy.
That's right. We just want the experience.
Yeah.
Very, very, very true. Very well said, Ricky. I'm so happy we were able to have you on to talk about the Disney theme park connection. We could probably talk about it for hours and hours, but
we can speculate until it actually happens.
That's right. That's right. And we get some people to tune in, I'm sure. So what we need to do, though, is we need to ask you our five questions that we ask all of our fans, to all of our Star Wars guests, to get an idea of the commonality we all share through our fandom. So I'm just going to jump right into it with you. What is your favorite Star Wars movie?
Definitely Empire. I mean, that's what everybody says, but it is.
Okay. Your favorite Star Wars character?
Yeah, you know, you sent me this list in advance, and of course I didn't think about it at all. favorite Star Wars character? I don't want to be so lame and pick the obvious ones.
What are the obvious ones? Oh, I don't think we have hardly had too many that pick right. the same one. We probably had the most Darth Vader, but not very many.
Yeah, you know, I think growing up watching the Star Wars films, I was always most drawn to Obi-Wan because he was the wise old man, but he could still kick butt. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he's willing to sacrifice himself. But then, you know, even when you watch the prequels, Ewan McGregor's a cool dude. And I think embodied the younger Obi-Wan very well. Probably one of my favorite parts of the prequels is just, you know, Ewan's roles throughout. So I would have to go with Obi-Wan, as sort of generic as that is.
Well, it's not generic. You're on Coffee with Kenobi. We love that answer.
Yes. Okay, there. That's exactly why I picked it, of course.
You know what's funny? You'll get a kick out of this. And on show number 19 that I mentioned before with Steve Sansweet, we asked him this question. He said, well, it's not called Rancho Jar Jar. So his favorite was Obi-Wan Kenobi, too. So
he's got a little bit of an Obi-Wan look to him, too.
He does.
Yeah, he does. He does.
That's good.
Were you tempted to try to interview him when you were around him all that time?
You know, it was so informal that it felt like friends hanging out the whole time. It wasn't so much an interview type of situation.
More of an
And
experience.
He kind of has that vibe to him anyway. He's just a
oh,
very
yeah, yeah, absolutely. He was as happy as the rest of us to be there and see all the cool stuff. He was playing with the toys and, you know, ready to take it home and add it to his collection.
That's cool. So what is your favorite line of dialogue or film moment?
Let's see what jumps to mind. There's a lot of great film moments. You know, okay, here's a line that I've always loved. It's Han Solo, and I guess they're in the midst of crazy outer space battle, and he turns to Luke and he says, "Traveling through hyperspace ain't like dusting crops, boy." I love that line. It's sort of summarizes him and a character. It brings Luke into it, and then, you know, it's sort of something that just comes out in the midst of chaos.
It's got that beautiful frenetic pace, kind of the pace of some of the 40s pictures, too.
That's exactly. Great. So, Ricky, if you collect, what's your favorite collectible that you own?
Okay, so my wife got me this a couple of years ago, and I don't even think I'm supposed to own it. But it's you know, the displays at Target that are awesome, and then they're supposed to throw them in the dumpster afterwards.
Yeah.
So some you know, they end up on eBay, of course. And so for Christmas, my wife surprised me with the Lego Darth Vader. It moves and the lightsaber lights up.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, it's really awesome. It's like 3 feet tall. So it's like a giant Lego Darth Vader.
That's very cool. That's, I wonder if even Steve has that. That's great. He probably does, but
he can't have mine.
Yeah, he may try to get over there. You better be careful. So what particular messages or themes about the Star Wars saga resonate or speak to you?
That's a hard one. I don't connect with sort of the religious undertones of it. I feel like that it really got really deep into that with the prequels. Mm-hmm. And I understand the connections have always been there with the Force and all of that. And, that part has never really jumped out at me so much as the more fantasy elements of it's really kind of the same thing, but not quite. I don't know. It's hard to describe. Sort of the notion that you can learn, You have it in you, but you have to sort of get it out of you, that like everybody has the potential to be a great something in the world. But you just have to have the, sort of the drive and the training and the belief in yourself that you can accomplish it. And sort of through your life as you work at that, eventually, if you work at it enough and you believe, you know, as Obi-Wan tells Luke as he's about to, you know, fire his shot into the thing in the Death Star, it's, you know, use the Force and it's in you and all of that. And I feel like that's true in life. I think anyone, you know, can pull off just about anything as long as you just sort of trust yourself and you go with it and you work hard.
I love that. No one's ever put it in quite that way. That's very well said.
Well, thank you.
So, Ricky, before we let you go, where can people get in touch with you and learn more about Inside the Magic?
Sure. Well, Inside the Magic, as you said earlier, is largely focused on theme parks, though we do cover other things, conventions and all that. I'll be at Comic-Con in just a few weeks, which I'm always looking forward to. But yeah, so the website is insidethemagic.net. That's where sort of there's links to everything. We have a tremendous following on Twitter and on Facebook and on YouTube as well. As you noted, I've put about a bazillion videos up over the last few days of Diagon Alley, but certainly plenty of Star Wars too, and Disney and everything out there. That's just a whole lot of fun. So any of those services, just slash Inside the Magic at the end of it will find me.
And we will certainly have links to all of that in our show notes as well. Well, Ricky, again, it's been a real pleasure. We're honored and delighted to have you on, my friend. Look forward to podcasting with you in the future. And thanks so much for sharing a cup of coffee with us here at Coffee with Kenobi.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for having me on.
Our topic for show number 22 is Ian Desher and his William Shakespeare Star Wars series. How has the series enhanced your appreciation for the Star Wars saga? How has Ian's work impacted your enjoyment of Shakespeare's work? What can we learn about the Star Wars universe through William Shakespeare's Star Wars, The Empire Striketh Back, and The Jedi Doth Return? Joining us on this topic is friend of the show and author of William Shakespeare's Star Wars series, Ian Desher. In 500 words or less, be sure to send us an email or MP3 with your thoughts, comments, or opinions to feedback@coffeewithkenobi.com.
I like the sound of that.
Echo 3 to Echo 7. Honno, buddy, do you read me?
I saw part of the message.
I seem to have found it.
Our first listener email comes from a great friend of our show, Randy Terrio, and he's been doing some voiceover work for us. You've probably heard his wonderful work at the end of each of our shows over the past few episodes. But he has an MP3 kind of talking about what's going on with the expanded universe, which is now Legends. Take it away, Randy.
Hey, guys. I wanted to take some time to express my feelings for the recent changes that Lucasfilm has put in place regarding the EU. It's taken me a while to work out just what my feelings are on the topic. When I first heard the official statement from Lucasfilm, I was flooded with the emotion of disappointment, but I wasn't sure why. The official statement that none of the previous books were considered canon in the first place was true from a certain point of view, I guess. I also know that my books are still available for me to read at any time, but that's not quite satisfying to me. I'm a huge fan of the whole Star Wars saga, including the books. I also consider myself to be loyal to the saga, so I didn't want to be critical of my favorite form of entertainment. I do, however, feel that I've been bait and switched, so here's my attempt at articulating those elusive emotions. I thought we were really getting somewhere with the most recent Fate of the Jedi series. It was pretty progressive, and I know some people didn't like the Abeloth character, but check this out. The original title of Star Wars was The Adventures of Luke Skywalker from the Journal of the Wills. Along the vast Star Wars timeline, there has been an underlying idea of a group of celestial beings. I always thought that having the galaxy beginning with the mysterious people was fascinating. One of my favorite Clone Wars cartoon story arcs is the Mortis trilogy. The father keeping balance between the dark son and the light daughter was really cool. But where was the mother, the matriarch? Pablo Hidalgo wrote in the Star Wars Encyclopedia that the Wills were holy people who could defy death through compassion. Was the Mortis family part of the Wills? Could Abeloth be the missing mother figure? Was the next series going to be about a quest for the sword given to Obi-Wan that could kill these powerful beings, the only weapon that could be effective in killing Abeloth? I feel like we're on our way to something really cool, and now it's over, and we'll probably never know. Another reason for my disappointment was my attachment to the new characters. I love characters like Thrawn, Mara Jade, and Jaina Solo. To think that they're not part of the timeline is so disappointing. I recall being moved so strongly emotionally when Jaina was forced to kill her brother Jason because he had become a Sith. That information may be a spoiler if that's the first time that you've heard that particular part of the storyline, but according to the powers that be, it doesn't matter, because it was never canon anyway. And you can't spoil something that never happened. Soon, new books will be published, and of course, I'll invest my fandom because I love Star Wars so much. Again, I'll read books trusting that it's part of the whole story. I think things would have been different if everyone was honest about the books in the first place. When I read the words "a long time ago" and "a galaxy far, far away," I believed in my imagination that it was true. The books were always marketed as a continuing story of the Star Wars saga. I believe that. So don't patronize me and say that they're still there, just go and read them, and then tell me they're not part of the timeline. Don't market and sell over 200 books as the continuing story and then get upset with loyal readers when they want to see or read future stories that don't walk all over the previous continuity. By the way, thanks for rewarding our loyalty to your franchise. I say all that to say that I'm looking forward to the new movies and the new books. I look forward to what the future holds for our heroes in the Star Wars saga. I would hope that fans could trust that the new canon will be one that holds true and is not thrown away in about 20 or so years, just like the previous storyline. I can't be the only one who feels this way, but maybe I am. I'd love to hear some feedback. My name is Randy, and those are my thoughts.
Thanks a lot, Randy, for the MP3. It was really beautifully done. You did a great job of putting your thoughts out there and making it emotional with the background of the music and stuff. It was really, really quite moving, actually. Really, yeah. Randy does some great voiceover work for us. He actually does the final intro for our Clone Wars. So yeah, check that out. And he also does our outro as far as our
regular shows
disclaimer. Yeah,
well, all the shows now, really.
Yeah,
his MP3 was moving and. And I think there's some of the things that I'm agree with and some things I don't. He's certainly not incorrect as far as, well, in anything. It's his very intelligent opinion. He says that he can't possibly be the only person that feels that way. And he's not. I think a lot of people that now know the expanded, we all know the expanded universe as Legends. And I think a lot of people were upset and hurt by that. But I've still always said that it was never canon. It was an addition to the Star Wars universe that they said it's, you know, it's out there. Pablo Hidalgo said, look, it's out there. Unless George Lucas or Dave Filoni tried to do something different with it, then it's not canon. It's never really canon. And again, Steve Sansweet on show 19 told us that it was never canon. So that's always been Lucasfilm's stance. It's not like they surprise us with this. It's just that we've had so much exposure and so many beautiful pieces of literature, and some, let's be honest, not quite so beautiful. It's been hard for people to accept. I still kind of feel that way about what DC did with the new 52. At first, I liked it, and now I almost have nothing to do with it. So I can understand this. I mean, the expanded universe has been around a long time, so his thoughts are very strong. I know a lot of people feel this way. What about you?
Yeah, I agree with you on that. I think also, I mean, it's not like they were throwing it in our faces saying, ha, we got you. You know, we're going to do what we want to do. It was,
right.
I think it was a very hard decision for him to make. If you could have been in that room, a fly on the wall, when they're making those decisions, what they want to do with the existing you at the time, now legends, I think it was a difficult decision. I think they didn't know what to do. And I think that they thought the best way to preserve the stories for what they are was to put it in this legend line. Say, you know, we recognize it as, you know, an almost an era of time that people could go back and experience and enjoy. Like he said, like we can go back and read those whenever we want to. I think a lot of people are hurt because they did get emotionally invested. Same thing with comic books, like you just said. We get emotionally invested in characters, and then they go and change the plot or change the lineup, or, you know, to a, we don't like it, and we end up, you know, changing things around. But, you know, it's just that's how companies work. That's what they do. I think Lucasfilm is taking the right steps, and Disney taking the right steps to kind of bring things together for fans. And whether we like it or not, they're going to do what they're going to do. I mean, as Yoda says, the future is always in motion. So we'll just have to wait and see.
That's good. I like that, Corey. I think that's, it's too bad Randy's not on here right now to talk about this.
I'd love to have him on, actually.
Yeah, he's got some great perspectives and insights. And it's a little bit of a different outlook than we've had on this new edition. And I think Randy, I'm sure Randy understands this as well as our listeners, but the main reason that they did this was not to undo what was done, but to say, hey, you know what? We're going to have Rebels. We're going to have new films. We don't want to be beholden to 1,000 other books that no one, a lot, not no one, please take that out. We don't want to be beholden to a bunch of other books that not every Star Wars fan who walks into the movie theater will have read. We want them to have a fair chance to kind of glom on to what's going on and embrace the story and the saga wherever it's going. So they want to make sure the creative people that are behind Star Wars now have free reign to do what they need to. And they've always said, look, we're probably going to take some things from the expanded universe or Legends because it's still there, but we need to have our own sort of free reign. So great job, Randy. We love it.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
There it is. Listen.
Hey, Skywalkers. This is Richard. And over here is my sweetie wife, Sarah.
You can call me Jedi Tink.
And we are
Skywalking Through Neverland.
Jimmy Mack here. When you wish upon a podcast, wish upon this podcast. These guys are awesome.
We are a fan-focused podcast that covers Star Wars, Disney, pop culture, and their fandom communities.
The stuff that surrounds us, penetrates us, and binds us all together as instantaneous friends.
What do you know?
We showcase what people are doing in the world of fandom and talk to those who are involved firsthand in the universes that we love.
This is Margaret Carey, Tinkerbell.
This is Jeremy Bullock, Boba Fett from Star Wars.
This is Steve Sansweet from Rancho Obi-Wan.
Hey, it's James Earl Taylor, the voice of Obi-Wan Kenobi, and I happen to be skywalking through Neverland right
and
now.
I'm and skywalking through
skywalking
Neverland.
Through
and I
Neverland.
Am skywalking through Neverland.
I've always hated space travel.
Skywalking Through Neverland is the ultimate expression of fandom. You can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, and our website, skywalkingthroughneverland.com.
And remember, Neverland on Alderaan.
Our next email comes from Mark Mulcaster, and he writes to us, "Hi guys, just thought I'd take 5 minutes out from work to send you a quick email. I've just finished listening to my first Coffee with Kenobi podcast, and I loved it. I'm certainly not new to Star Wars podcasts, and I've been listened to. I'm certainly not new to Star Wars podcasts, and I've listened to many over the years. And your show's name has been mentioned recently on quite a few. I generally can only listen to podcasts on the commute to and from work, but I'm going to be adding your show to my must-listen list. I think that's what's so great about Star Wars podcasting in general is that you get such a wide view and opinion from people, which can sometimes be lacking from what I see on some social media outlets. I still haven't quite decided on how spoiler-free I want to be during the course of the Episode 7 build-up, but I admire those who will intend to try to be spoiler-free. I have to admit, I did try to click on the TMZ picks and click through them all, but I don't think it gave too much away. I certainly don't go hunting for spoilers on the web, but if something is dangling in front of me, I'm going to bite. That being said, I'm also very much aware of the link baiting and Overtrick's news sites used to get traffic. I think the only way to stop the leaks would be to ignore them. If we didn't click on the links, if we didn't share them, or if you guys, podcasts in general, didn't discuss them, then I think the webmasters of the sites would notice that by their site traffic decreasing and maybe bother another franchise. But I'm a realist, and that's not going to happen, as you have alluded to in your last podcast, number 20. There is a percentage of Star Wars fans who have to know everything and know it first. If that smug, I know something you don't know syndrome doesn't make them think they, as fans, are elevated above everyone else, and they're the ones that will click on those links. It seems for a lot of us, it's human nature to want to know. The same as hunting for gifts before your birthday and Christmas. I wonder why as kids we did this. Was it some notion that by knowing what we're going to get from our parents, that if the gifts suck or if we didn't quite get what we wanted, we wouldn't be upset? Or is it that we're just impatient? Working in TV and to a lesser extent films, there's nothing worse than working on something for months, crafting it to perfection, and trying to keep things under wraps only for someone to leak story points or other spoilers from the set. The question I asked myself as I sit on a spoiler-free fence is that, will spoilers help to ground expectations of the film? Whilst I love the prequels in Episode 1 especially, the most underrated Star Wars episode in my opinion, I'm also aware that its biggest downfall was that it didn't meet people's expectations both of the average cinema goer and a proportion of the fans. Is Episode 7 at a risk of repeating this? People think that by shooting on 35mm and using practical effects, as well as having the original cast back on, it's going to recreate the magic of the original trilogy.
And he goes on to say, but this is 30-odd years on. We've grown up, marginally anyway. Society has changed. For Episode 7 to strike lightning twice, I don't think it needs to recreate anything, just to continue to tell a story, and itself has grown up and moved on in 30 years. But what if the script and story sucks? For some people, their wildest fantasies, hopes, and dreams of what should have happened in Episode 1 meant that no matter what the story was presented by George Lucas, it was never going to meet their expectations. And now the EU slate has been proverbially wiped clean. Are we now going to speculate to the point where we fall into the same trap? What would happen if something leaks that actually the fan community doesn't like? If the pivotal plot point or story point turns out to be really crap, how would fandom handle this? Could this damage our expectations to the point where we enter a stage of apathy before the release? Contrary to the email, I'm an optimist. I was excited about Disney's purchase, and I continue every day to be excited about all that is about to happen. No matter what happens, Star Wars is forever, and it spans multi-generations that can get as much or as little out of it as they want to. Thanks for taking the time to read. I look forward to listening to your next episode. And that's from Mark Mulcaster. Thanks a lot, Mark, for the email and your thoughts on kind of the upcoming Episode 7 and kind of the we talked about spoilers back with Bobby Roberts as our last episode. And yeah. We kind of went on to kind of – I know we don't spoil here on Coffee with Kenobi. We don't like to go into that kind of stuff. It's certainly up to the person, individual, to do what they like to do. And if that's okay. I mean, that's up to you guys. I mean – I think Noel, Dan, and I like to kind of keep ourselves spoiler free as far as in general and sure. any different dynamic as far as genres.
Yeah. Is it safe to say that you're a little more adventurous when it comes to speculation than I am, or do you think we're on the same page?
I'd say we're more on the same page, but I mean, I see stuff that comes out and I just laugh to myself. Like some of the stuff that I see, I laugh because I don't click the links, but I read the headlines, and I'm just like, this can't be true. I mean, if it is, I'll see it in theaters. And I'm not going to sit there and speculate, well, you know, Tom Cruise might be in the movie. Oh, no. I'm not going to even speculate why he's in the movie. If he's not going to the movie, who he would play. I don't really care. If he's in the movie, I'll find out when Episode 7, scrolls on the screen. But
and when I read things like that, my eyes glaze over, and I just almost like I tell myself, just forget about that. Who cares? And then I just, I'm just trying to move on.
Yeah. Well, he makes a good point. I mean, it's up to the. I understand what he's saying. I think in general, it's asking a lot to put a Star Wars film out because Star Wars fans have almost come very biased over the years, the past 30 years.
What do you mean by biased?
Well, I mean, just as far as, the books, the EU books, and the prequels and stuff. Not everybody really likes that stuff. But here's the issue, or the different perspective. There's a whole, like he said, this, Star Wars is generational. So you have that fan group that doesn't like the prequels because of XYZ. They're the the guys who sat in theaters in 77. And maybe that's not true for everybody. But I also think that there's a new portion of fandom that's the young portion that came up with the Clone Wars. And they're, sure, you know, they enjoy the newer stuff. They enjoy the spoilers. And so there's a whole different dynamic there, too. We have to take into account, I think, sometimes that fandom that's a younger generation that have grown up with the Clone Wars and, you know, are maybe into spoilers, or, you know, they're a little more tech savvy. They're younger. So I think that there's an older group, there's a younger group. And for that, going into episode 7, it's going to be really different, because when the prequels came out, you know, we always had that older group mindset. And now we have a younger group mindset as far as new fans.
Padawans and younglings, grown-ups too, it's the Star Wars Kids Cast, the only podcast and blog in the galaxy for kids and for grown-ups who grew up on Star Wars too. Star Wars fans of any age, if you like Star Wars books, you like Star Wars toys, you like Star Wars stuff, come join us at Star Wars Kids Cast, available on iTunes, Stitcher, and at starwarskidscast.blogspot.com.
And it isn't grown up at all.
Chewie, get us out of here!
If you would like to respond to our question of the show, have a comment, or just want to say hello, send us an email or MP3 at feedback@coffeewithkenobi.com. Or if you have a specific question or comment for either of us individually, email us at danz@coffeewithkenobi.com or coreyc@coffeewithkenobi.com, or visit us at coffeewithkenobi.com and click on the Contact Us section, or comment on one of the stories featured on the site. If you enjoy the show, please write a review in iTunes. You can also like the show on Facebook at facebook.com/coffeewithkenobi, as well as keep up to date on our Twitter feed at twitter.com/coffeewithkenobi. You can also find us on Tumblr at coffeewithkenobi.tumblr.com. If you enjoy the jazz music, download the album Eye to Eye by Steve Torak on iTunes.
Give the evacuation code signal.
That's it for show number 21 of Coffee with Kenobi. A big thank you to Ricky Brigante for having a cup of coffee with us and discussing the Disney and Star Wars theme park connection. Be sure to check out InsideTheMagic.net for his latest Disney and theme park news. Thanks also to Aaron Harris for talking about Star Wars Weekends, for being such a fantastic contributor to our show.
Thanks to our media specialist, Lisa, as well as all of our Coffee with Kenobi bloggers and Rob of the Bearded Trio for all their contributions to Coffee with Kenobi. A big thanks to everyone who contributed to this show, and to all of you out there who listen to and email Coffee with Kenobi each and every week. Don't forget to send us your comments and opinions on the topic for show number 22, Ian Desher and his William Shakespeare Star Wars series.
This is the podcast you're looking for.
This podcast is not endorsed by the Walt Disney Company or Lucasfilm Limited. It is intended for entertainment and informational purposes only. The official Star Wars website can be found at www.starwars.com. Star Wars, all names, sounds, and any other Star Wars related items are registered trademarks and or copyrights of Disney and their respective trademark and copyright holders. All original content of this podcast is the intellectual property of Coffee with Kenobi unless otherwise indicated.
There's no one here. Move along.